Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty. Oh, wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. They're the ones who's coming up and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children, teach them the very best you can. But just let it be. Na 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 na. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it now, just you and me. Wake up all the doctors, make the old people well. They're the ones who suffer and who catch all the hair. But they don't have so very long judgment day, so won't you make them happy before they pass away. Wake up all the builders, time to build a new land. I know we could do it if we all lend a hand. The only thing we have to do is put it in our minds. Surely things will work out, they do it every time. Just let it be. Na, 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 na. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it now, just you and me. Change it, yeah, just you and me. Change it, yeah, change it. Can't do it alone, can't do it alone. Need some help, y'all, y'all. Yes, I do. Need a little help. Say it for me. Need some help, y'all. Change the world. What it used to be. Can't do it alone. Can't do it alone. Need some help, yeah. Need some help, yeah. Wake up, everybody. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. We got.
So welcome back to Questions, Answers, and Solutions. Tonight is going to be of an interesting conversation. We are coming in with a parenting experience and different perspectives on what parenting actually means. So I want to first give a shout out to Radio Rima, who is the engineer for the night from FLO Empire Radio. I want to give a shout out to my number one supporter, Todd Taylor, who's always in the house. Unfortunately, he's on his way here with Andrea, but I'm going to open the show up with Danny and Janessa. So if you're tuning in, you can tune in to buildingsafercommunities.com/radio, or you can call in to join the conversation, because like I said, it is going to be an interesting one. You can call in to 929- 227-4646. So without further ado, I'm going to allow Janessa and Danny to introduce themselves. So Janessa, you want to start or Danny?
Go ahead, Danny.
Hello, everybody. My name is Danielle Beckett. I'm a senior court clerk for the Brooklyn Civil Supreme Term. I've been there about 3 years. I'm also a mommy, was a single mother for many years, or most years of raising my sons. But I am now newly married.
Yes.
Congratulations. Congratulations. Yes.
Not so new, but just.
It's still new.
So you're under 5 years.
You're going to give us two perspectives.
Like yes. Okay. Okay. Exactly. Yes. I'm going to give two perspectives.
Excellent. Awesome.
And also a perspective on, you know, the grown child back home and, you know, economy and stuff. Yeah. Sure.
Good stuff. Janessa, give it to us.
Absolutely.
Hi, my name is Janessa. I am a court clerk at New York City Criminal Court in Manhattan. I am a mother of two, one natural birth, one by adoption. And I am a single mother. And I also was born raised in a single mother, single parent household. And my mom married my dad. And then things change for me. So I have perspective as being raised as a single child, a single parented child, and then having a dad as opposed to my two kids that it just got me.
All right. So let me ask the question. Let me just open a line up to this first question. And I also want to add that Michelle Patton-Coy and Rosalind Morrison are going to be on the phone line shortly. So maybe okay. They'll call in about 8:15, 8:20. Again, okay. If you're tuning in, you can tune in to buildingsaferecommunities.com/radio and or call in to join a conversation or ask questions at 929-227-4646. All right. So this is the first question that I have. What does parenting mean to you?
To me?
It's very broad, right?
Oh, gosh, it's very broad. Because I also, my prior job, I had to somewhat do that because I worked in a New York City school system. So to me, parenting is just the whole covenant over a child, yours or ones that are not yours biologically. And you have to do everything, you have to see everything, you have to know what they're going to do before they think they're going to do it. Mm-hmm. Parenting is just, it just means a total life project.
Wow.
And yes, a total life project that you're constantly on and you're constantly doing. And it just, and it encompasses your whole life.
Forever and ever.
Yeah, means life, means love, it means heart, it means, you know, all of the above.
Okay, all right, so we're looking at a holistic approach here. Janessa?
For me, parenting is absolutely everything. For me being a parent, I think out of everything that I've ever accomplished in my life, being a parent was the best thing that ever happened to me. Mm. Being a parent saved my life. It really did. I made a post the other day on Facebook because my kids are 17 and 21.
Yes.
And the post was, I still go in the room at night to kiss my kids. Like, they still give me so much joy with everything that's going on in this world. And when you think your kids could be out here, God, I'm so grateful. And rearing them, parenting was never hard for me. I had support. I had good kids. My kids weren't wild. They weren't on the street. They weren't crazy. So it worked for me. And I've also been exposed to that other side where mm-hmm. I recently had a child who was in foster care. Mm-hmm. Come stay with me for about a year. And that was tough.
Was that based on kinship or was
that was based on kinship? Her mother is currently away.
Okay.
We'll leave it there.
Her mom away at college.
Y'all know what it is.
Okay.
But she's away getting better.
Yeah, she's getting better. Mm-hmm. And this child she's a lovable child, but she has issues.
Okay.
And it was one of them things where the parent in me wants to cater to her. The parent in me wants to rear her. The parent in me wants to discipline her. but the system take doesn't allow
right. Right.
You I want to
body
create
parts,
her to be better.
Piece by piece, yes.
But that's not in the cards for her at this current time, but we going to pray because God is good.
Yeah.
God is good, help. But parenting is just life for me.
Yeah, I can I can agree with you with what you said about that being lucky because I have two boys, which everybody, you know, the knuckleheads.
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
30 and 28, but no jail.
Wait a minute. Wait, back up. Did you say 30 and 28?
Now for the camera.
Exactly. Are you looking at Danny?
30. Matter of fact, past 30. Now I'm ashamed to say that, actually.
Okay.
Past
don't be. Because you look great.
I was 30, 28, but, you know, like, I have a million things I have to remember. And I'm rounding it off. No, 32. Okay.
Oh, 32.
And 29 for the youngest one, November.
Excellent, wow. Excellent. So you don't have the best of both worlds. Actually, yes. Janessa, you have the best of both worlds. Yes. You have a girl and a boy.
All right.
So I think I went three. I have two girls. Yeah, I got two girls and one boy.
Wow.
So my boy is in the middle.
A boys are.
Oh, yeah. 15 years old he is.
Like, and no rap
11
sheets?
And 19.
No children, no gangs, nothing. They really have never brought me that. I'm not saying that it was easy, and I'm sure people who know me and know me very closely that are watching knows the kind of woman I am.
The kind of mama you are.
Yes, the tough love, the, you know, just, ooh, I hope my sister's listening to this. But those type of things, they really never brought me. And, you know, sometimes you have to make it so you're a little crazier. They think that you are so that
and
you
still
know.
A little bit of fear.
Yeah. Yes.
Oh yeah.
And still a little bit of fear so that they know.
And you know, it has its pros and its cons.
Not to push.
It does.
Huh?
It
and
really
I
does.
See it now that they're men and you know, just all the stuff that we've been through. But I mean, like you were saying about the child that's from the foster care system, you look and you think you have problems and then you look at somebody else and you really don't have nothing to complain about.
Because I go in that room like, I'm so glad I got y'all. Y'all are so good. Thank you, Jesus.
And they know
like,
how far to go.
And they know.
I'm glad I did that. Yes.
My kids, and the you know, the rearing stages, I have this joke where, you know, how people listen to the you know, you put
the music on the stomach.
You
yes.
put the music, the headphones
that.
On your belly, and you let the baby listen.
Yes.
So I have this ongoing joke where with my kids, I'm like, oh, I put music on you, Javette. Because that's my daughter's name, Javette.
Yes.
I put music. I had the headphones on my belly when I was pregnant with you, but it was like, I will beat you down.
Wasn't saying that.
So
down.
It was a message from the womb, so she knew when she arrived.
Excuse me.
She
it's
knew
not
that
a
voice.
Game.
It's not a game. Yeah. I'm not playing with you, little girl. And I never had to, you know, so much as like really hard, give her the look. And she was like, okay, mommy, I'm good.
Right.
I'm good. But yeah, that was it.
All right, really so am lucky.
Go ahead, Danny.
Yeah, I'm just saying that I really am lucky because, you know, two black boys in today's
that's
society.
That's very challenging.
And, you know, it's, like I said, it was very rough because most of them being raised, I was single. So it's a lot of stuff they didn't agree with, a lot of stuff that they even still don't now because they're men.
Mm-hmm.
And I have no problem with them coming to me and saying it. You know, you did that 10 years ago, you did that 10 years ago. And I'll say, well, you know, I did the best I could with what I had and the tools and everything that I had.
Which most parents do.
I always say to them, look in the mirror now. I said, I was the type of mother that I will sacrifice our relationship. So if you walk past me for the rest of your life and you never speak to me, that I'm cool with that. But you're a productive man in society.
Wow. That's
but
right.
But you can't ever forget that.
That's right.
That's what I say to them. So you can be mad at me and you can hate me with this and I couldn't go here and I couldn't fly there and I couldn't do this or couldn't bring this girl in.
Oh, Lord.
But look at you now.
Yeah, you go through those challenges with the boys. One woman in the home.
Yeah.
And look at right. There was always that challenge.
One woman.
In the home.
We don't do several phone calls and several visits and knocking on the door.
No, we're not doing that.
Yeah.
All right. We'll remove the hinges, and then there'll be no doors in the house.
So you were strict, huh, Danny?
Strict maniacish.
Okay.
That's what I'll say.
Give
and
us
like
an
I
example,
said, those
Danny.
Are that close to me now.
I mean, I guess it's a little
tricky.
Bit it's harder. It's
very
harder
quick.
With boys. So.
Oh, yes, it is.
I had to go to a training when I was in NYPD school safety, and that training made it so that I was home earlier, but unbeknownst to them, they didn't know. So the oldest one had the little girlfriend in there, and his friend had one, and they were in there, you know, I guess doing what, you know, what boys and girls do. I don't even know. But they were so engaged in what they were doing, they didn't even hear me come in. So I went in, I grabbed my sledgehammer on my bat, And I stood outside the door and I listened. Then I bust inside the door. I said, what the hell is going on here? I said, and then I looked and I saw pots on the stove. And I said,
y'all feasting?
I said, young ladies, rule number one, you never go into another
woman's kitchen.
Kitchen, but I didn't put it that way. But we all know, those who know me know how I put it. And then I also said to them, I said, I also don't even see where there was any, the shower curtains are not wet. There's no, you know, sweat from that. And they looked at me like as if to say, well, I don't understand. What do you mean? I said, that means that nobody was in here washing, but y'all was in here getting ready to do the funny business. I said, and then also, did you ever think, or did it occur to you, and I'm standing with the bat like this looking at them, because I'm about to swing RBIs, real bad injuries. I said, did it ever occur to any of you two dummies, you and your homeboy here, that these girls can go tomorrow to a precinct and sit and say that y'all forced them to do this?
Wow.
I said, you two stinking little heifers, did it ever occur to you that they could have had three or four other dudes jump out of the closet, and this would have been a different type of party? I said, all these things plus venereal diseases. I went and I got the dictionary. I slammed the thing on the table, so I had the bat, the book, the dictionary. I said, all of these things. I said, then nobody can say that. Y'all just in here about that. Do it up. You had to see them girls run down the step.
So wait a minute, Danny. So you went strict. You went corporal punishment, and you went educational on them.
That's right.
Without further ado, let me welcome Andrea to the table. Hi.
Come up
to the mic. Yes. So we're welcoming you. We're going to allow you to introduce yourself. And we also have a caller on the line. So let's welcome that caller as well.
Is that dark and sweet?
Mm-hmm. Hi, caller. Who am I speaking with?
You want black? You asked for black?
Rosalyn?
No, I said dark and sweet.
No, it's Michelle Patton-Coy.
Hey, Michelle. How you doing?
I'm good. Hey, Danny.
Hi, Michelle.
Welcome to the conversation.
Thank you for inviting me to share. Hey.
Absolutely. Okay, so let me give Andrea the opportunity to introduce herself. Andrea.
That's how you're supposed to say it. Yes, Andrea. I have a girlfriend named Andrea, and we call her Andrea.
All right, Andrea, introduce yourself, and then I'm going to let Michelle introduce herself.
Okay, well, my name is Andrea Harris, of course.
How are you?
I am also a single mother. My daughter, she's 17. She just started college about 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
And I was invited by a talk.
Yes, absolutely. And thank your family. You.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Oh, and your family.
All right.
Blood.
That's right.
Blood fam.
With the royalty colors on. She has on purple.
Okay.
Michelle, introduce yourself.
Hello. Good evening, everyone. I'm Michelle Patton-Coy, and I was invited to come on the program by Jameer. I think because of the topic, I have 3 children, and it seems like I have the babies compared to everybody else on the show. My oldest is 13. I have a 10-year-old, and the 13-year-old is a girl. The 10-year-old is a boy, and I have an 8-year-old who's also a boy. But I didn't start out as a single mother. My story is as follows. I was married in 2000. And I was married to a man who I dated since we were 19 years old. We got married at age 26. And so we got married, as I said, in 2001. In 2003, we had our first daughter. In 2006, we had our first son. In 2009, we had our second son. So 3 children in all. And then on June 17th, in 2011, my 35-year-old husband dropped dead of an undetected heart defect. So, you know, I came to this single motherhood quite unintentionally, and it is nothing that I would have chosen to do, but it is my reality at this point. So I am trying to make the best of a situation, and thank God I'm from a strong family, and also I'm married into a strong family, and I have the support of my parents and my late husband's parents, and I have dear friends who are supportive of me and who come in to bridge the gap. And that's where I am. And so I'm also very interested to hear some of your techniques in dealing with, you know, the teenagers and learning how I can deal with my current situation. So
well, we got a Michelle, we have a lot of that. And you know Rosalind is going to call in, so she's going to come in with her perspective as well. So we're going to dig deep for the next hour and 20 minutes. Hour and 40 minutes, actually. So, Andrea, how old are your children?
My daughter's 17.
17. Mm-hmm. Oh, you have one daughter.
I just have one.
Okay. All right.
I would have more, but what happens is once you become a single parent, and sometimes it's not as easy,
you learn quick.
Yeah, you learn, and that's what I did. I want more, but...
All those things above, okay. Economic, okay. You know, emotion, right? Yeah. Really, it's mostly emotion. No,
so I have to be fair. I want to ask you this question, mm-hmm. Andrea. What does parenting mean to you?
Everything, honestly. Once you have a child, everything. It's you being your best. It's you changing your life. It's you, now you have a responsibility. You have a life that you're responsible for. It's like... No more games. It's serious. It's let's do things the right way. Let's
not
take shortcuts. You know, let me show you what it is. You know,
sacrificing.
And then also living in New York, it's like, let's be honest here. You got to try to protect your kids all the way around, and you got to teach them to, you know, be aware of the side eye, be aware of the swifters we have here in New York. You know,
yes, a lot of adversity.
But it means everything to me. I mean, my daughter has changed me. Yeah. Change my life for the better.
All right. Let me pause one more time and welcome Rosalind Morrison. Rosalind, you on the line?
I am. Hi, everybody.
Hi, Rosie.
So what I'm going to ask you to do, Rosalind, Michelle is on the line, and you know we're all sitting at the table, and we want to make sure we hear you. So just speak up just a little bit more. Okay, Rosalind?
Okay, will do. Is this better?
Yes. So welcome to the conversation. So tell us a little bit about yourself and what you think about what parenting means to you.
Well, I caught the tail end. I don't know of whose comments, who was just speaking, but the sister that was just speaking really embodied a lot of what motherhood and parenting is to me. Just how your children, to start with, I think that children choose to be born through us. You know, I think it's a spiritual thing. And so we're meant to parent the children that we parent. Like, they come to us, they're a gift, they bring out.
It worked out that way.
You know, they're meant to challenge and grow us in the ways that we need to grow and be challenged. And some of that is not an easy thing. Some of that... You know, they know how to pluck those nerves, and you will, but it's a beautiful experience, you know?
Yes, it is.
They, like, when I had my son, I didn't really know that I could love that deeply, you know? And, he's very much, and it's funny because he is 10, he's starting the very beginnings of pre-puberty, so, you know, he's grown a lot. You know, he's taller, his body's changing, just the very beginnings of it. And so, you know, there's a little bit of moodiness that comes with that. So there are times when I feel like, we're incredibly close, but there are times when I can tell we're getting on each other's nerves, and I have to bring the balance. And so there have been a number of times over the past, you know, I would say 6 months that I've started... When I find myself getting really frustrated with him, I'll just chant, "He's my blessing and I love him. He's my blessing and I love him."
You told me that the other day, Rosalind. We all have to find a chant at some point. Because if we don't, they'll drive us crazy.
Yes. It does. And what it does is, like, I still may have to correct him or sit him down or admonish him or do my job as a parent. But it kind of, I just noticed that it really shifts the energy. And I'm able to do it without, you know, as much frustration or just whatever it is I'm trying to check on my part. It just really takes it into a more positive space.
Okay.
And he picks up on that energy, you know.
You'd be surprised.
That's the closeness in your relationship.
You'd be surprised how your kids know exactly what you're going through. What,
and how you're feeling. I hate that.
Or something will go down and they look at your face and they know.
Stop.
When it's, okay, mom is not doing good, I'm going to go sit on the side.
Yeah, or mom is serious.
Right.
So let me just take a couple of steps back.
Or something's bothering her,
Right, that's the flip side. They know when we had enough of them, but they also know when to come and give that hug. Mommy, you that's okay? True. Like,
or looking true. Like they can do something.
Right. Yeah. What can I do for you? You know? And, mm-hmm. And it's like really a blessing to have that. Mm-hmm. To yes. know that your kids recognize who you are in mommy mode.
Right. That comes from them coming through.
Stress from work. That, and, yeah. you know, yeah, it, it's amazing. That, yeah,
that's what Rosalind said. Yes, right. That comes from them coming through you. You're right, that, Rosalind.
Yeah, you're right, Rosalind. coming through you. They feel what you feel.
Absolutely. Michelle, you still there?
Yes, I'm here.
So, Michelle, what does parenting mean to you?
What does parenting mean to me? Well, I think it's an awesome responsibility. Parenting is, it's being able to be a guide for another human being, being able to nurture another human being. It is, I mean, I think it's one of the most serious jobs a person could ever have. And I call it a job because it is, there are light moments and there are fun moments, but on a day-to-day basis, especially I think at the age of my children right now, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of scheduling and getting people where they need to go, and it's a lot of work. But it is the most important job that I have, mm-hmm. and you know, it's definitely something that is allowing me to grow. And I agree with Rosalind in that I do think that the children you have are the ones that you're supposed to have, and the ones who are supposed to allow you to learn things. And they are definitely allowing me to grow into a better person.
Isn't it amazing sometimes how you could sit back and one day you're frustrated and then you realize next week how much you did for the week or how much you did for your children, and it's like,
yeah,
I did all of this.
You, yes.
I got all this done.
Back. Yeah.
My bank account still got some money in it.
That's right. The bills are paid.
The kids are happy. Mm-hmm. Everybody is just good. And
or that they're grown and you see your traits. Yes. The ones that they fought me hard.
Yeah. I mean, and for those of us who have children who are older, yes. you know, because I would say that my 19-year-old too, and Michelle hit it on the nose, you put in so much
and
work.
You think you
and it's
didn't.
Like you don't see it right then and there. Sometimes but as time goes on, you say to yourself, oh my God.
That's right.
And Janessa, you brought up a valid point when you said that children feel you, they connect to your energy. And I think Rosalind said the same thing, mm-hmm. because Kayla is in college now. She's away. But when I'm going through something and I'm feeling like, okay, it's time for me to take a break because I don't know what's about to happen next, I always get a text from Kayla to say, I got 100 on my test. Yeah. You know, I just got another job. I'm doing X, Y, and Z. I'm
or like, something, well, yeah, they tell you something good.
Something positive. Yeah. Yep. And I'm
cause
like,
to
wait
me,
a minute,
it's like,
God,
right, they're saying,
are you talking
chill
to
out,
me?
Calm down.
You know?
Right, things are not that bad. You
talking
think they
to
are.
Me?
Or I do everything you say. Like, my son will say, you have two good kids. I don't know why you talk the way you talk and, you know, go nuts all about this and that and everything. Because you're scared.
Yes. Yes.
Especially today's society. I have two young black males.
Yeah.
So when they're gone and they're out, okay, you're grown. Okay, you can do this, do that, and then both of them work. But I am scared to death, especially in light of the events that happen now. So I constantly tell them different types of things, and because of the place I work in, so, you know, you got to do this this way, and you see that you can't say that to the cops, right. You can't do this, you got to do it.
Oh,
and they look
yeah.
at me like, oh my God, like, you know, we got a little street
a lot of
smart
pressure.
Savvy.
Yeah. A lot of pressure.
But it is pressure, you know.
It's a lot.
I love it that I can contact them, and at first, because I was like, oh God, get out, but
right,
no,
it's a different type of feeling when
it
they
really
move
is.
Out.
When
my mother told
the
me
oldest
that.
One moved out, I laid on the floor,
like, used to be on my mind, now you on my heart,
yes,
right, big difference
because you don't, it's like that world is cruel, not so much that world is cruel, this world is cruel, baby,
yeah,
and
yeah.
even when it you think you know, I was your age,
you up right. and spit you right back out, Janessa,
with my oldest, Javette. Just graduated college with her second degree. And I remember her thing. Yes, my baby had 2 degrees.
All right.
Yes. And I remember when she first started going to college, I said, I just want you to focus on school. I just want you to focus on school.
That's all your
so
function
she said,
is, right.
Okay, mommy, that's it. And let me give you a little backstory. I didn't go to college. I didn't get my college education until my daughter was in high school. So she was maybe in, let me correct that. She had just graduated from high school when I was decided to go back to college. Mm. 2 years. So, Javette, I said, I don't want you to work. I just want you to focus on school. Mm-hmm. And I did all this. Oh, girl, you know I worked. I did all this overtime, and I went to school, and I did everything I could. Just so
I'm already looking like a donut.
My daughter could just focus on school and school alone. Mm-hmm. So what she did was she went out and got a job. I didn't know that. And when I found out, I was angry because I'm like, I want you to focus. It was nothing more important to me than her education. Because I didn't want her to, I never wanted to be the parent that was going to school when my kid was in college. That was not the plan for me. But God saw different. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When she got her grades, because I found out she had went, snuck behind my back, and got a job. When she got her grades, she had a 3.5 GPA.
That's right.
And I'm like this. How did you do this?
That's right.
How did you do this? This was
motivation.
I said, how did you do this? How did you go behind my back, get a job? She said, Ma, I didn't want to ask you for money. I wanted to do it by myself.
Well, she wanted to get it done.
That's
all you.
Here it is.
That's where it came from.
I said, how did you do this? You remember that old commercial? I learned it by watching you.
That's right.
I used to come home from school and fall asleep. She was cooking, and she would fix me a plate. And I would do my homework in the bed with that plate, and I would fall asleep. And she would come and get that plate and take them books and pack my books up and cover me up and turn off the TV.
Yeah.
And I couldn't understand, like, they really watch you.
Yes. Because watch she your turned moves around and everything.
And did the exact same thing.
That's right.
And she said, I watched you. You did it. So I knew that I could do it. And she didn't want to be a burden to me. And I'm like, this kid is like 18 years old. Yeah.
Or they'll say, but you did it, Mom.
Yeah, but
so you think I couldn't?
In my mind, it's some children I'm the
mature
mother.
Faster than others.
I'm the
mother.
Yeah. And then what was a blessing was she graduated 1 week, and I was at her college graduation, and I graduated the next week, and she was at mine.
That's right. That's right.
You do it when you do it.
It was purpose that way, and I'm grateful to God for it because she had to see that to be the woman that she is right now, to be that person.
That's what she's looking at.
Yeah. So now she's home.
As opposed to something that would be, you know, negative.
You know, I did the party dance when she left. I was like, yeah, I'm in the house.
Freedom!
But that thing right there, what you said, now when she comes home, she's a graduate. And it's like, oh, Ma, I'm going out. It's 1 o'clock. You going where? And she's like, and well, what do you think that I was doing when I was at school? I thought she was home in the house sleep.
Or going to bed at 10 o'clock after you did your homework.
It's too much freedom.
How could your mind not?
Well, it didn't. Don't judge me. Okay. See what happened next year. She going to be like, my baby was in the dorm.
I'm hip to the game.
Yeah, but the change now is I have this young woman in my house.
Ain't they funny when they're grown? Ain't they funny?
Yeah, who's not asking to go out anymore. It's just like, Ma, I'll be back later. Or, Ma, I'm going out. And I'm like, well, what happened to Mommy? Can I go out?
Well, we're going to talk about that's another question that I'm going to propose about rules and regulations.
Yeah.
And at what age should you enforce them? But let me bring Michelle and Rosalyn back into the conversation. Yeah. And I want to hear from Andrea. Michelle, I know that you mentioned earlier that you're a little bit on a different, you come from a different perspective because your children are much younger. How is the scheduling for you and how does that pose a challenge? Because I know you work hard and I see you every day looking good. So how do you keep that together?
And I haven't visited that in years. So Michelle, please.
Yeah, Michelle be doing her thing, you know. So Michelle, how do you stay to get all the way together and then put your scheduling and everything together? Yeah. And also Rosalyn, you come in too because Austin A is still at a younger age and I have an 11-year-old, so it's still a lot of work to do and my son is 15. So Michelle?
Yes. Well, first of all, thank you very, very much. But what I will say is I have a lot of help. And my parents are giving me immense support, and my in-laws are giving me incredible support. Mm-hmm. But my physical being is, I realize the importance of keeping my physical being as together as I possibly can because I have so much to do. So it's important for me to have the energy to be able to run around with them. Mm-hmm. I have my two boys are in baseball. On a Saturday, they could have games all day. You know, I have a daughter who she's into acting. She has different productions. They are all so busy, and they have lives of their own. And they're also three very different children with different interests and different needs. And many days, I feel like a glorified chauffeur.
Oh, yeah.
I am just, you know, driving. I look at everybody's schedule, and I figure out how I can get them where they're going. Mm-hmm. And when I can't do it, I can call my father. I can call my father-in-law. Nice. And, you know, I have friends who are dear to me who step in. Mm-hmm. But it's not easy. But I make sure I go to the gym at lunch. I make sure I do my meditation and try to calm myself in the mornings and in the evenings to get through this race. You know, it's not easy. And I also, there's a time when I realize that I'm raising them so that they will one day leave. And I want to be happy with who I am at the end, too. I think that it is there's going to come a time, just like I've left my parents. My parents have two children, and we've left the home. And they, like I said, they're still so involved in. I see my parents every day because they're so involved in raising my children. But you have to come to an understanding that you're raising them to be individuals, to go out and make their own way. Mm-hmm. And I understand that day, even though they're young, that day is coming, and I will still be Michelle.
That's scary.
And I still want to do the things I want to do, and I don't want to be, you know, mashed up by the time they're old enough to have their own life.
She want to still be looking good.
Engine running.
That's right.
She want to be her baby.
That's some good stuff. That's some good stuff.
Yes, you look great. Michelle.
Roslyn, how are you feeling about what we're talking about, and how are you keeping yourself so put together and jazzied up?
Yeah, well, you know, it's definitely been a process for me. You know, I, just to take a little bit of a step back, is that in terms of, you know, I ultimately got what I needed from the people who parented me, but, you know, I was born from a woman, and I just really... It took a long time for me to really understand why I chose to be born from her. And I think that, you know, it was because it was just my role to be a cycle breaker. So, you know, my mother abandoned my sister and I, so we went to live with different family members. And, you know, it was really, she was very detrimental to us. I do understand that. You know, she had her own issues that she needed to work through. So pretty much, I mean, I was fortunate to have my grandmother, who was just an incredibly beautiful spirit, but she, you know, passed away when I was 8, you know. Mm-hmm. And, you know, then we went to live with different family members. So I have had some examples of good parenting and some... people in my family who did love me the best that they could, you know, but I was always aware of the fact that I was kind of, you know, an orphan in a lot of ways. And, you know, so when I had my son, it was really, you know, I just showered him with love. You know, it was really important for me to make sure he knew that he was wanted in every way. You know, and I wanted to spare him. I never wanted him to feel like an orphan or to feel like I didn't want him or didn't value him. So, you know, initially, at the early part of his life, I really just sacrificed, like, you know, in some ways it was all about motherhood, you know, cooking, cleaning, making sure he's okay. He didn't sleep well. So, you know, even now, if his breathing pattern changes, I wake up. Now, I don't always get up like I used to, but I'll wake up and listen and make sure he's good.
And go in the room and give him a kiss like Janessa does to her baby.
Yeah. I do. But
big baby.
Like,
yes, give him a
doing
punch.
That, I was starting to lose myself. And you know, it took me a little while, but I realized that it's a lot of, like, what Michelle was saying, in that you have to be balanced. I have to be an example of a good and loving and caring mother for him, but also have to be an example of self-care, because now that, you know, they watch everything that we do, more than what we say, they watch what we do. And, you know, I can't be an example for him of someone who just sacrifices everything, including my health. So, you know, it's something that I've gotten a lot better about. I would definitely say over the past couple of years, maybe 3 years or so, to really include myself in the equation, you know, when it comes to balancing things out. So then he'll, you know, because he's going to be in a relationship and he has to understand that it can't always be about him all the time. You know, he gets a lot of time and attention and love, but it can't just be 100% him and 0% me. So,
give and take,
you know,
yeah.
Also just the schedule, like Michelle was saying, is bananas. Like, he goes to a small private school. He plays like 3 different instruments. He plays the African drums, percussion, drum kit, piano, and he does like hip hop dancing. He loves basketball, science and math. So this summer was a combination of like basketball and math programs. So it's definitely a lot of running around.
Yes, yes. And Rosalind, I want to thank you for sharing that piece about, you know, how everything originated and you questioning the reason why you were reared by your birth parent. Because that kind of like pierced my heart, and I'm sure the other ladies listening feel the same way. Yeah. I'm going to ask a small favor, Rosalind. I'm going to ask you if you can drop the line for about 10 minutes and then call back, because we can't have 3 callers on the line. We can only have 2.
Oh, no problem. Okay.
All right, but I want Rosalind, I know you got to, are you doing homework?
No, I'm not. I'm
Yes. Cause you know, I'm checking in because I know you'd be running around.
She's reading
in that house. All right now, all right. So listen,
we had our moment and everything, and he's now in the tub doing his thing. I'm in my room.
All right, that's what I'm talking about.
It's mommy time.
I'm not folding. Listen, I'm not folding clothes. I'm not cooking.
Good.
I'm not
okay.
Doing
good. So you're going to dedicate this time to us. All right. So this is what I want you to do.
Call back. I'm listening. I'll hang up and call back.
In exactly 10 minutes.
All right, sis. I got you.
All right, Rosie.
8:51, Rosalind.
All right.
And yes, counting.
Okay. All right. Talk
bye.
To you soon.
Bye.
All right, baby.
Okay. Bye.
Hey, caller. Who am I speaking with? Okay.
Danny,
all right,
one
so
of your sisters.
Andrea, let me bring you in a little bit, because I know when we initiated the conversation, when you came in, you said that, you know, you are in a single parent home situation right now. How is that for you?
It's not easy. It's not easy at all. It's never been easy. But, you know, I realized that you got to take what you got and you got to run with it. If you don't, then you'll fall. You know, it's like as a parent, all you can do is do your best. And when you have children, you realize you're going to just get it done. It's a get it done attitude. Mm-hmm. You know, okay, for example, my daughter, like I said, she started school a couple of weeks ago. And as far as I was concerned, school was paid for until the first day of school. All her classes got dropped. Oh. So she's just looking all pity, you know. And I'm like, what's going on here? Mm-hmm. You know. But they said, okay, well, you make what you make and you're going to have to pay half. Oh, didn't expect that.
Oh yeah.
So now, boom. You know, and it's like single parent.
Another right. Bill.
You know what I mean?
And they wanted in the next 72
hours. Where do y'all think I'm getting
this from? Exactly.
Right. You know, like not right now, but right now.
Right.
Like
exactly.
Yesterday, class is gonna drop exactly. off the
like
earth.
This.
Oh
yeah.
Not just drop.
I don't right. dance no more. Right. I make money moves.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
And it's funny because you were saying before, you know, your daughter worked. My daughter, she got a job, and then she had got a second job over the summer. And I'm just like, you're just doing too much. And, you know, it came down to it. And she's like, so, Mom, what are we going to do? I'm like, don't worry. Don't cry. We're going to be just fine. Mommy going to work 6 days. We're going to do this and get it done. And that's
get it.
And she was like, so what am I supposed to do? Go to class.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all you can do. Yeah. You know what yeah. I mean? You just yeah. have
don't
to make
late.
It happen. It's not about daddy. It's not about grandma. It's about you, your child, or your children. And you just get it done.
Got to make a dollar out of 15 cents.
That's let me bring in the caller, because I know the caller's been waiting patiently so we can continue this conversation. Hi, caller. You on the line?
How you doing? I thought I would get VIP treatment. You guys got me on hold.
I apologize. Who am I speaking with?
This is Tim. How you doing?
Hey, Tim. Nice to hear from you.
Hi, Tim.
Hey, Tim.
So what are you doing? What are you bringing to the table tonight?
I just want to say it's kind of hard being a parent. Me, myself, I was like the youngest of 11 kids. And my father, he didn't know how to be a parent. My mother, she didn't have much, but she gave me a lot of love. I knew my father loved me, but he was one of those people that didn't say I love you and stuff, but I know he did. And I was like the total opposite of my parents.
Yeah, right.
Like, I have 4 kids by 3 different women. Mm. But what I do, I spend time with my kids. I got a friend, he's like 75 years old. We've been friends for a while. He said, I didn't know what it was to be a real father, so I've been around you. He said, I thought being a father would just give your kids money. Mm. But he said, I see how you spend time with your kids. Like, my kids, they was in Georgia. One was in Maryland, one was in Virginia, and I get my kids together like every holiday and always go see them every birthday. Oh. So I don't just give them money, I give them time.
That's right.
I show all my kids love.
Yeah.
That's good stuff. Let me say something boldly, Tim. You bold for calling in, and it was 6 women on the line.
All these women
about,
in here.
You know, you real bold, Tim. So I admire that, you know, and I think again, you know, just as my heart was pierced earlier, my heart is pierced now. And I'm glad that you mentioned the fact that not only do you provide financially, but you also provide that time. Because so many parents, and I'm going to make this as a general statement, because there are some absentee mothers as well.
That's right.
Right? So we want to acknowledge that. And we want to acknowledge that there are fathers out there who do what they have to do. And of course, sometimes it's underreported, but they're out there.
They're out there. Mm-hmm.
So I want to say thank you so, so much for calling in, giving us your input in parenting. So let me ask you a question, though,
speaking
really quickly,
your truth.
to see if your truth matches the young ladies on the panel today. What do you think about parenting? What does parenting mean to you?
I think it's easy. Parenting to me is just taking care of your kids and guiding them in the right direction.
Okay.
And I think it's easy. I never had a problem with my kids. When I was married the first time, I remember every time we had a housekeeper, and every time my wife would come home, like, the house was a wreck, the kids were screaming and everything. But I remember I was out on comp one time, and I was taking care of my kids, and my wife had called. She's like, where are the kids? I'm like, oh, they're in their room. She's like, what, are they asleep? I'm like, no, they're not asleep. When she came home, they were quiet. The house was clean. Dinner was on the oven.
Wait.
And she's like, how do you do it? How do you do it? I'm like, it's easy. It just comes natural.
That's because you got the daddy voice. The daddy voice different from the mommy voice.
Yeah, they treat you different.
It's almost bad cop, good cop.
Yeah. Yes, they treat you different.
He ain't there talking about sit down in there. Yeah. They doing what they're supposed to do.
Tim knows that.
Tim knows that. That's a common answer, Tim. Sorry, Miss Beckett has to chime in and say that. And because I've witnessed it, actually. Right. So sometimes it is good to have a man around because it just changes the whole tone.
Yeah.
Sometimes you got to shift it.
Changes that tone.
So take them.
So thank you so much, Tim, for calling in.
Okay.
And,
and it's funny,
so
my friends, they always tease me, too. They like, it seems like you try to be everybody's father, because I look out for any kid. Any kid that needs me, I'm there for them.
Yeah. It takes a village, Tim.
Yeah, it does.
So thank you so much for calling in tonight. We appreciate your support.
No problem. You guys take care.
All right, you too.
Hi, Tim.
Take it easy, Tim.
All right. Good night.
Michelle, you still there?
Yes, I'm here.
All right. So I want to erase the stigma really quickly. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I say that, Danny was like, what? What's
your mom? What stigma?
So, yeah. So there is a stigma to say that a child needs or children need 2 parents in order for the child or children to be productive. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about what I think with that. If it's a single parent home, as long as the parent is productive, the child or children can be successful. The same with
for mothers and fathers, the same thing for a two-parent home. If there's a two-parent home, both parents must be on the same page. They must be productive in order for the children to be productive. And it's in its most beautifulest form, because we all know that children can come out of a home that is considered or generalized as a dysfunctional home and still be successful. Oh, yeah. So how do you guys feel about that? Danny, you want to take that?
Well, it depends on what's going on in the home. So you can have a block where there are a man and a woman, and they have two kids. And then on that same block, there's a woman with four children. That home that has the two parents, daddy cannot be around all the time. Or whatever the situation may be. They may be seeing abuse. They may be seeing emotional abuse, physical abuse, you know what I mean? Like that. So, to me, single home or two-parent home, I think it's the experience that, you know, the parenting experience. Of course, you know, I won't say it's a stigma. I'll say that, yes, you know, purportedly you want the mother and the father and, you know, in its natural state, or in its mm-hmm. natural course, you want mommy and daddy in the home to raise the children. And, you know, that just goes back to values and culture in most, you know, different societies, most homes, or most, you know, different nationalities. But I never thought it was bad that there was a single parent. I just think that it's bad in a sense that you need help. That's all, you know. Yeah, they'll say, oh, you can't do it by yourself. But some people do it. Okay. So I've never thought it as a stigma. I know that my parents didn't want me to have my kids. When I did, I have no problem saying I had my first son at 18 mm-hmm. /19.
So did I.
Yeah, so did I.
I just, yeah, I'm a go-getter. When I found out I was, I had a job and a place lined up, and I was going to, you know. My mother said, look at this little sneaky heifer. She got a job. You got this going on already. She done started a whole nother life, and I don't even know about it.
You was out there getting two jobs like they kids?
Man, and when I was working at one job going to college, I never finished, but going to college because I have my, you know, thoughts on the book stuff and the, you know, the teaching stuff. But, yeah, I will never think it's a stigma because of all the things that I've seen from way back with my aunts from down south and grandma and Aunt Florence who ran the whole beauty parlor by herself outside the house. And right, so, right, you know, when you look or you go back and look at just different customs and values, mm-hmm. that wasn't really a problem other than some gossip. Like, oh, look at that heifer over there. She pregnant. She got that kid. And they don't know whose it is. Could have been Uncle Joe's because, you know what I'm saying? Like right, that.
Some things were going around.
No, I don't. You know, there are pros and cons. Yes, always will be with me. And, like, being a single mother, there was times I was like, damn, I wish this man was here. You know, instead of the weekend pickup or the. Mm-hmm. Because I had that situation. They, you know, they know him, but.
You were primary. Just,
we were, yeah, I was primary. I was, you know, how you going to get it if I don't give it? And then he would just, you know, fall in and take up the slack, which still helped. I'm not dogging him at all because mm-hmm. we were young when we did it, but we still took care of our own responsibility. And it was just a struggle, you know. When you young and you have a kid, you just, you know, you're young, you're stupid as hell. So, you know, you think you know everything and you don't. And I come from tough love because y'all.
So do I.
We know.
So do I.
We know you, Danny.
So you made it. You take care. You know. You did it. Whatever, like that. You know. Mm-hmm. She's real. You know. Real rigid. I'll use that word for my parents. So yeah, I don't see nothing wrong with that.
All right. So I want to welcome before we move on to Andrea and Janessa. Let me just welcome the caller to the line. Excuse me. Hi, caller. Who am I speaking with?
Dawana.
One more time.
Dawana.
Hey,
hi, Dawana. Where you calling from, yes, Dawana?
I'm so country, I know.
Yeah. Where you calling from, Dawana?
South Carolina.
That's what's up. South Carolina in the house.
Can we get all a plate of food?
Okay. I'm telling you, send us something up here to eat.
Collard greens.
You know the city food.
That would work. The comfort food during the conversation.
Exactly.
And that's what the kids need. That's what I'm talking about. These kids need good food.
That's right.
Yeah, so these pop-up.
So, Dawana, you want to add to the conversation? You have a statement or you want to share something with us?
Well, Well, my very, very dear friend, Andrea, is
hey, girl.
On your panel. Oh, you guys are friends? Okay, okay, all right, all right. The love and support is in the house.
She told me not too long ago the idea came up about the panel. She's like, you think I should do it? And I said, of course. It's good to tell your truth.
Yeah.
There is someone out there right now going through what you're going through, and they don't think they can do it. But you need to be that voice to say, it's hard. I know. I did it, and I'm still doing it, and we're still good. So I just want to congratulate her for always, from day one, I've known her for years, being that mom to make a way when she sometimes felt like there was no way. Yeah.
And doing it now.
Good stuff, Duana.
To me, shout out to all the women who have, like Michelle, younger kids now and have to come up through this.
Yeah.
I was, you know, that Run DMC 80s, 90s era, and I was whining and bitching about that. But now I'm looking and I'm going, oh my God. Like, if I'm on a train, I see a bunch of kids coming, and I go, let me go to the other train car because I want to play mommy. Yeah.
I don't want to slap nobody.
So, that's what I'm going through now. Yeah. Raising my daughter. It's like, because I was
kudos
away.
To y'all for now in today's society.
About 5 or 6 years, I went to school down south, and then to come back. And my daughter's culture here, shop. And it's like, Mom, New Yorkers are rude. I don't want to be here anymore. We need to go back down south.
Yes, so right.
The mannerisms and are definitely like, different.
Yeah, she's
very
Southern.
The one
she is.
Is.
She is. All and right. It's like, now you have to raise her to know, you know, like I said before, this is breed. New York.
Yeah, you got to get home you one know?
Different
breed. Yo, look out. Yo,
Mom,
look out.
I'm on the bus, and this creep is looking at me. I'm like, just hold your purse, and in case something, you know, just be prepared. Just be all right. You're going to be just fine, you know.
Just I got stay away from Joey.
Cab drivers driving crazy. You'll be just fine. You know what I mean? Yeah, it's like,
this
is New York. But in a way, it's a good thing, too, because they're getting, you know, they're experiencing life.
Right,
you know, and it's
not
like,
in the bubble, so they'll know. Yeah,
yeah,
outside
too.
Of
what
the
what
box.
To expect,
absolutely,
to expect.
Absolutely.
All kinds. Traveling is the best education too.
Yeah, it is. Especially in New York.
And I think before I move on to Andrea and Janessa with the industry question that Danny already responded to, sheltering your kids sometimes can be very complicated.
I've done
and
it.
Trying to protect them from everything that's on the outside because you know what there
I've
is to
it.
Come, right? So life is an equal opportunity butt kicker for all of us, right? And we just don't want to see our children go through those struggles. We want to protect them. We want to shield them. We want to mold them. And, you know, there's a whole
can't
process to parenting.
I've done it.
But I could talk for days about that part.
I felt
but
like I had to.
How do you...
go ahead. This is Michelle. I wanted to actually address the question you initially asked, and Danny had an opportunity to answer. Yes. I really think, and I'm speaking from my personal experience.
Absolutely.
When you're talking about it, is there a stigma attached to having to being from a single parent home? What I want to share is that I think there are different ways to look at this situation, and one is just like a straight division of like the distribution of resources and the allocation of time. It is challenging for one person to take care of all the responsibilities that need to be taken care of for a child, and I don't. What I find for myself is that when my husband was alive, I was able to be a different expression of myself. And I mean it in this way. Like, when my children would misbehave, I would say, oh, wait till I tell your father. You know, as soon as I get home, I'm going to tell your father, and Daddy's going to take care of it.
Had the backing.
And then he would take on, when I got home, he would take on that certain line of discipline, and I was able to be a different mommy. Since my husband has died, I find myself now having to morph into a different person because I don't have that personality
two
in the house.
Split.
So now I'm doing that, and that's not necessarily who I had been. When my husband died, we were almost married for 10 years, and the children were 2, 4, and 7. So I had 7 years of parenting in one particular way, and that had to change. And to be honest, now I'm kind of, there are times when I'm a little schizophrenic with it. Because I'm taking on one role, and then I'm coming to the
multiple
personalities.
But that's okay. That's okay.
Yes. You have to be civil.
It's not a bad thing. Mm-hmm. You have to adjust to what's going on at the time. That's just part of being a parent.
And then
I just feel that just based on the things that need to be done, it is beneficial to have a male in the household and a female in the household, or two people at least. If you have 3, 4, 5 as like grandparents and everything, if you don't have that other person in the household, you have to have other people around to help you bridge the gap. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we should discount the role, and not that anybody is, but you need the male figures in the home, and you need the female figures, and you need all of that. And that's what I wanted to say about that. But I also, just to add, like I love to travel, and I've been traveling with my children. And every time we leave the country, people approach us and ask, "Where's the man?"
Mm, yes.
Really?
Yeah,
yes. That's every the reason
people
time.
Still stigma. Really? The stigma of a two-parent home exists.
No.
They do.
And,
a stigma.
I'm sorry. I would
in different ways and different
well, is yeah. it? And, yeah. Right, Michelle, I mean, it's different cultures.
It's offensive, and that's why I say the stigma, the stereotypical, that box that they put parents in, that generalization that both parents should be there. And that's the reason why I propose the adversarial question, mm-hmm. About that stigma, because it's out there. And sometimes people do sneer and they stare and they ask questions on why is there only
every
one
time,
parent?
Every time.
Why aren't you married?
It's
why,
not your business. That's why.
That, business,
across the board, that's
why
totally
you're here
true.
By yourself with these three
it's
children?
It's totally true across the board, but that doesn't say that the stigma still doesn't exist.
How is it that you
exist.
Would be here? Where's your husband? Did something happen?
They do that.
Every time without
That's very bold.
Yeah,
I would say,
Well, I'm very bold, but...
Yeah, that is a little intrusive.
I've learned to deal with it, mm-hmm. and it gets easier, year over after year, but it's still something that hits me.
How dare you, right?
Right,
But, and I mean, I usually will respond as he's
not,
home with his
I'm
wife.
I'm past the how
friends.
Dare you. It's like, I mourn because I'm saying, okay, am I going to explain what happened?
You don't have to.
I'm on vacation.
You don't
I'm
have to.
Does it make you any less than?
Am I going to now explain? But I've learned that it helps for me to explain because it also allows people to understand that there are different families and there are different ways to be successful.
And life happens. Yes.
That's right.
Yes, we still get to travel even though we don't have a father in the home. Right. So it's
yeah, I would tell them they still allowed me on the plane without a man.
Yeah.
Right, Michelle? They still allow you on the plane.
But even within my family, like I'll tell my parents, oh, I'm taking the children to Greece. And they'll say, how can you do this on your own? I think we need to go on that trip. How are you going to do this? So there's all of that, and I had to get strength within myself to say, I'm doing it because I want to do it.
That's right.
And I'm not going to wait for
and you're doing it
a
because
man
you can
to give
do
me permission
it.
To do it
right?
or to allow
capable.
These things to be possible for my family.
Right.
And
Michelle,
you need to do it because it teaches them that they can
do
it.
That's
and they don't have to explain it.
And it's 2017 and people are asking that.
D, are you still on the line, D, from South Carolina? Okay. So,
I'm still here.
So D, let me tell you, I just want to say thank you so much for calling in. Thank you for your love and support for Andrea. Thank you for your love and support for calling in and just, adding that, shedding that light. For Andrea, but I'm going to ask you to drop the line, right, and still follow in with the conversation because I want to bring Rosalind Morrison back and I want to hear some words from Janessa, who's been patiently waiting, okay?
Okay, I got to get my babies in the bed anyway.
Let's see, there go that parenting thing. That's what I'm talking about. All right, D, and I'll make sure when I'm passing through South Carolina, I say hello, some Southern hospitality. All right?
She is.
All right, babe. She hung up? Okay. Rosalind, if you're looking at us, if you're listening to us, call back. We're leaving a line open for you. So, Janessa, come in because there's been a lot of conversation and I want to hear from you.
Okay. So, my truth is this. I grew up in a single parent household. it was just me and my mama for a long time. My mother worked at the post office and the police department, and she ran to that school because I got walked home by teachers, and she showed up at the school with the belt.
Roz, you there?
I'm here. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm glad, and you're late.
The line was busy. And she had to get the baby out the tub.
That's right.
I have been trying to get back on the call since 8:50.
I know. Listen,
I'm backing you. I knew that.
That's that mother intuition there. She's like, I was trying. You know,
and
I know,
she had
no
the
time. I know.
Yeah.
I heard the phone ring. All right, baby. Glad that you're back. Michelle, you still there, right?
I was listening.
All right, good stuff. Janessa, come on.
So, single parent household. My mom worked at the post office and the police department, two jobs. And I got walked home from school every day. And they called her at work and she would come down because, you know, back then corporal punishment was okay. So she would come to the school with the belt around her neck and handle her business.
What is it?
And
today?
Nobody, you know, they didn't complain. I wasn't dying.
Mm-hmm.
But I gave my mama a run for her money. And I regret it to this day. Like, I'm still sorry for the child that I was. But the funniest thing is, my mother and my stepfather had dated from the time that I was 4 years old. They got married when I was 15. So at 15 years old, my mom gets married and we move into his household with his son. Back at my house, where it was just me and mama, if I did something wrong, I got beaten.
Right.
In this new house, it was none of that. It was, we had family meetings. We had discipline talks. We had punishments that I couldn't go out.
Change.
The dynamic changed.
Okay.
All the cutting school and the running, acting a fool at the school, that wasn't tolerated. See, my mother worked two jobs, so I got away with everything. You know why? Mm-hmm. She just gonna beat me. She's tired, and she's trying to provide for us. But now the dynamic has changed because now I have a father, and I love him dearly. He's deceased, but I that's my daddy. And he made the difference in my life not being my father, but he was my daddy. Mm. And when that dynamic changed, it was like, I don't want to disappoint my daddy. And my life changed. My life really changed. And I adored this man. And I went off to college and I got pregnant and I disappointed my daddy. And he said, you gonna raise that baby. And he was upset and he was angry. And she came. And he adored her.
Mm. Of course. That grandparent love.
That grandparent love is a different kind of love.
They flip right over.
Yes, they do.
My parents know I was at the baby. I landed over there. She smacked me, but after that,
my mother was the best mother that she could be for me. Mm-hmm. I had issues because she worked all the time, because she was trying to provide.
That's what my kids find with me.
My dad came along and he made a home for me. My mother didn't have to worry about those things. My mother didn't have to work two jobs. My mother went back to college and my daddy paid for everything. You know, my mother, she was a working housewife,
mm-hmm.
but she had a job. And he was one of them men that was like, your check is yours and my check provides for this family and this household
primary
and these
breadwinner.
Children.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
he was that kind of man.
Mm-hmm.
And I needed that man. I needed that man to show me what a man was supposed to be, because then I wouldn't have ended up with my daughter's father. But I needed that.
Life happens.
And it was good structure for me.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here is the flip side. My father was there when I had my daughter, but I was a teen mom. So I'm fresh out of high school. I'm just getting old enough to drink. And now I got this baby, and I ain't ready. I know I'm not the only teen parent in this world. It was like, I don't want no baby. But my parents were like, you gonna have this baby. I wasn't the best mother. When I had Javette, I still wanted to go hang out in the street. I had a pass. I used to, you know, smoke a little weed. We all have our demons.
Yes, yes.
And I remember one time where I had my daughter with me because I used to think I was hurting my parents. I'm going to take her with me since nobody want to watch her. I'm going to take her with me. And I would hang out in the projects with my girlfriends and get high. And my father would come down there and stick his hand in that stroller and feel that stroller was wet and slap me being grown. with this baby and take my baby. I learned how to be a parent. I had two great parents. I went from not having a dad to having a dad. So I got to see both dynamics of it. Mm-hmm. And here I am, knowing both dynamics. And then I become this horrible teen mother. But because of the love of my mother and my father, I had learned to care for this child. I learned the proper procedure for this child. And it changed me. I was not the best mother, but like I said in the very beginning, my daughter saved my life. Truly saved my life. And for her to grow up in a single parent household, was it really a single parent household? Yeah, it was me and her. But my mom and daddy lived downstairs. Mm. And when she didn't want to sleep in her bed, and I would call my father and be like, you hear this girl crying and screaming? Papa, why you let her do this to me? My father would come upstairs. He was her dad too. Mm-hmm. He would come upstairs and be like, your mother crazy. You don't want to sleep in the bed? You ain't got to. And he would take her.
That's that grandparent spoiling.
Yes. But it worked because they were the best of friends.
Yes.
When I had to work on Saturdays and Javette started playing basketball, Grandpa took her to basketball practice. That was their thing. And it was like, don't intrude on our space because Saturday morning belongs to us.
Right.
So she had him. And that development, and I really believe that's why she is structured the way she is, because she had that male role model. She had that person to say, this is a man. This is what a man is supposed to be, because there's nobody here for her to see that. There's mm-hmm. nobody else for her to recognize that in. So I had the best of both worlds, right. And I needed that.
I can't admit that with grown sons. Even though they're well-rounded, they're good and everything, knock on wood, I can see where they missed it. Definitely. I can see where they missed it in just the way they carry themselves and the comparisons. When a man is comparing
right.
themselves to other men and how they deal with women and their relationships. Yep. Mm-hmm. But thank God they're also well-rounded enough and they can articulate it to me. So now we do have those conversations, because there is a difference of a man being in a house as in opposed to the visits on the weekend.
And there's a difference in conversation. Let me bring Nicola on the line and then I want to hear from Andrea. No? Oh, okay. Okay. So Andrea and then Roslyn and Michelle chime in.
Well, I don't think it's necessary. I'm just going to straight out say it. I don't think it's necessary for a man and a woman to be in a household. I wasn't raised that way. I was raised by a single mother. Mm-hmm. And also my mother was young. And then she had a brother. I had a little brother as well, or a bigger brother, should I say, as well. I grew up in a house where my grandmother, my grandfather lived. And just about all of her kids, we all lived together. And... to me, that's what's necessary. As long as you have family around, it makes a big difference. My grandfather was a working man. He was never home. You know, I see him for a minute. It was a knock on the door. Poppy, can I get some ice cream? Give me a couple dollars. Go back downstairs. Yeah. Get my
ice
cream.
That's what he showed y'all. That's why everybody works.
And that was it. Primary, you know what I mean?
And that's why you work. Mm-hmm.
Primary breadwinner.
And it wasn't easy with my mom, you know, as a single parent. She had apartments, and it was like she'd sleep on the couch, and we'd sleep
sacrifice.
In the room.
Sacrifice.
You know, or we'd have the same thing every night for a few nights in a row, but it wasn't a big deal. Days. You know what I mean? To me, it's just more so about love and support. Yeah. It doesn't have to be a man and a woman in the house. I just don't look at it that way. My daughter has to come a lot, you know, and me being a single parent, and it's like you said, your children, they save you.
Yeah.
I wasn't a bad little girl. I wasn't. I fought a lot. But I wasn't. I wasn't a bad little girl.
Just had a little knucklehead in you.
Yeah. I like to fight. It's just, you realize these kids, they save you. What I'm trying to get to is, let's see. I don't even know how to say it.
I want to bring you back to South Carolina and Dee when she said that whatever you have to say tonight is going to be a message for somebody else.
Yeah, it's my message is it's not easy.
I know.
It's not easy at all, but you can do it. It's not even you can do it. You have to.
You don't have a choice.
Right. That's something that I realized.
Listen, you got a choice because you have some parents out there who choose to do other than what you guys have done.
when you realize that you are responsible for the life of another person, the life of your own, because whatever our kids are doing, I know I'm looking forward to Social Security at some point in my life, and these are going to be our little governmental people. So we're owed that. We have to give them the best that we can give them. Okay. Because we're going to get
just
that
repetition.
Back. Yeah.
I just watched what my mother did, so I'm like a machine. The machine kept going.
I started college in 2000. My daughter was born in 2000. It took me about 10 years to fulfill my first college degree.
Wow. Right.
My daughter struggling. My daughter seen me.
And you did it.
Doing everything I had to do. And it's funny because about a year ago, we came back to New York and she was skipped. She went straight from 10th grade to 12th grade.
Oh, good
and
stuff.
Now, there you go. She's in college. And it's like, here she is. Mom, why don't you go back to school? Mom, wow. Why don't you go back to school? Mom,
yeah.
You know, at this point now, I've accomplished a lot. Yeah, mm-hmm. I have now 3 degrees. But it's like your child, they see you.
Yeah.
And they do the same.
Yes,
you know what I mean?
Fight
and they surprise you.
Yes.
And then that's when you sit back and you say
but
to yourself.
But I don't say nothing. I just keep it to myself and go.
But it makes you feel good.
And it was worth it. All the struggle was worth it. Let me cut you guys off again.
Yes.
So, Michelle, you still on the line?
I'm here, and I have a question.
All right, wait, Michelle. Michelle,
Rozzy,
give me 1 second, okay? Because what we got to do is, Michelle, now it's your turn. I got to ask you to drop the line for about 7 minutes. 7 minutes,
no,
Michelle. And then you got to call right back, okay?
Okay, no
so
problem.
Do yes, like Rosalind Michelle. And keep calling until you get us.
Okay, 7 minutes.
We'll All right, do. 7 minutes.
Okay, bye.
No. All right, let me bring in the next caller. All right, Rozzy, you wanted to say something while and then I'm going to bring in the next call, okay?
Okay.
Go ahead.
Well, especially, you know, your question of whether both parents or, you know, both parents, but if you need as well as the woman's presence in the house. And, you know, this is something that I'm really grappling with now because my son's father and I ended our relationship when he was 3, but we, you know, and initially started out me being very committed to co-parenting, even, mm-hmm. you know, we joked about how there was, thankfully, it was a very short period of time when we were just co-parents and not friends, you know, because he was getting on my nerves and, you know, but, you know, the Austin, our son, and both of us wanting what's best for him, got us quickly to being co-parents and friends. And I think that's important. Like we're all, even after the relationship ended, I still have a very good relationship with his family. You know, his parents are, you know, mom and dad, you know, even now. And I think that means a lot. You know, there were times when Austin, they would say to me, you know, let's do something together, you know, and we would make that happen. He, Sanu, Austin's dad, and I would have family meetings, you know, to address different things. Okay, I'm noticing, sometimes he would bring to my attention, I'm noticing I have to talk to him a lot, and you must be too, and you know, let's sit down and have a joint conversation with him about listening the first time or this or that, or, you know, letting him know that we will get in that behind if we need to, you know? And I think that really meant a lot. Now, there were definitely times when I felt like, boy, this would be a lot easier if I wasn't always the primary. But I do have to say that, you know, in a lot of ways, I could always tell, like, our relationship didn't work out, just really because I knew in some ways was kind of immature in ways that we weren't going to be able to work through as a couple. But he always, always loved our son. And, you know, he has other children that being a father was a very important role for him. And, you know, he actually passed away the end of last year. And, sorry. He just really, you know, it was just really incredible because, right, you know, I was like several months before he passed away. I could see the maturity in him. And I remember saying to a few of my friends, like,
you know, I know it's always been good people, but he's really, it's a beautiful thing to see how he's maturing and how he's interacting with Asane and Asane's older brothers. And I'm really interested to see how this is going to develop, you know? And so basically, in a lot of ways, like, I feel very blessed because, I mean, he had a great relationship with his dad, but I also have a community of people, men, who have, you know, at my temple, at my community, on my block, that have always been there, and they've stepped up even more, you know. So, I mean, of course he misses his dad. I miss his dad, but, you know, I'm not sure. Like, I know we're going to be okay. I don't think that it's going to be easy, but, so in a lot of ways, like, I'm still trying to figure out, you know, that balance and to make sure that, you know, that there is enough of that male presence in his life. And I think so far I'm doing a good job because, you know, he misses his dad. We talk about it, but he is really taking it in such a mature mm-hmm. and courageous way, you know.
Because he's like a young man, he feels like he has to step up.
People yeah. in our neighborhood have said, you know, we watch him, and he is really, you know, you're doing a great job with him. Yeah. He's really okay, you know.
He's assuming happy. His role,
he's
Rama.
He's adjusting so mm-hmm. well, mm-hmm. you know. So, you know, this is just something that I'm kind of, we're growing and transitioning, you know.
So, Rosalind, let me cut in just a little bit because I think we have another caller on the line. So let me welcome that caller. Caller, are you on the line?
Hello.
Hi, who am I speaking with?
This is Kian.
Hey, Kian.
Hey, how you doing?
Kian from where? Is this my cousin, Kian?
Hey, I'm watching a live feed. I guess it's like lagging behind.
Yes, yes. This is my cousin, Kian. Welcome to the conversation.
Hi,
so,
Kian,
just give me one. Give me 1 second, Kian. Let me say something to Rosalind. Because okay. for the third time tonight, I mean, my heart has been touched.
Yeah, she
but
got
it was
me.
Touched again, yeah. and I was about to get all emotional.
Yeah.
But for
Mine
good reason.
I'm listening along, but, you know, I didn't know what to say. I don't know if there was any questions posted.
Kian, give me 2 seconds, okay? Give me 2 seconds. So I'm trying to address part of the conversation that we were just having with Roz and some of the statements that she made. And I just want to say thank you to her as well as Michelle for bringing up such a moment in time in their life that right now they're still grappling with. And that yeah. is the fact mm-hmm. that they no longer have the fathers in the children's lives and their lives because they passed away. Okay. So okay. I want to say okay. thank you so much, Rosalind, for sharing that information with us. Just like I told Andrea, there's somebody out there who's listening to you and who needs to build off of your strength. Your energy is flowing in this room. So I know that the viewers and supporters are feeling your energy, that kinetic energy that we talk about all the time as well. So with that being said, Kian, let me bring you into the conversation. Yeah, so what do you want to say? What do you want to say, Kian, about parenting?
I don't even know. I guess when I... geez Louise.
We're not going to beat you up.
That's what he's thinking. He's so shy.
Take your time, brother. Take your time.
Say the right thing.
Okay, so let me ask you a question then so I could gauge it. How important is it for you to be in your daughter's life?
Oh, man, you already know how I feel.
Talk to us now.
Oh, man. It's such a foundation. I mean, just to give a little backdrop, I've been broken up with my daughter's mother since me and my daughter, mm-hmm. since my daughter was 3. Yeah. And my daughter's about to be 10 this year. So, yeah. For me growing up the way I did, you know, I was I don't want to say fortunate because that, you know, it comes across as for some people, mm-hmm. some small minded people, in my opinion, that comes across as bragging. But I was fortunate enough to grow up with both parents in a household. Now, I'm not saying every day was a sunny day, but, you know, nonetheless, God blessed me to see both sides of the spectrum. Now, I will say that it's extremely important for a young girl, in my case, that grew up for her dad, because I feel like a father provides a certain type of structure in a daughter's life that she can't just get from her mom. And another thing I want to touch on, just piggybacking off what I just said, there's a passage in the Bible. It's often referred to as iniquity, passing fear, judgment, and doubt down from one generation to the next. So that's a grandmother going, don't do that because my mother didn't do that. And then now, you know, the daughter's going to her daughter, don't do that because my mother didn't let me do that. And now my child's being raised with, I can't do this, I can't do that because my mother didn't do it and her mother didn't do it. And, you know, that also stems from, you know, a lack of male presence in the household as far as my daughter's mom and her mom and so on and so forth, which is, you know, just a long line of not being committed or married, you know, a marital setup. Whether that's not that I'm placing blame, it could be anybody's fault, but not that there's any fault to be placed, but I'm just saying that, you know, whatever the circumstances may be, however they lay out, it's extremely important for a father to be in the household because there are things that a daughter specifically, even a son, can learn from a father that a mom or a woman just can't teach.
Good stuff, Ken.
Yes.
Good stuff. Wow. So you another bold one like Tim, huh? You calling in, you have seven women that were on the line, and you calling in as an integral part of your daughter's life who's 10 years old now. So I just want to thank you, number one, for the support, for the love, for calling in and giving your insight from a father's perspective. That's very important.
Definitely. I'd like to thank and commend all you women for coming up here and sharing your stories as well. You guys are extremely courageous.
Thank you. Everybody
is struggling with something. Yeah. As far as, you know, the times of now and just what's going on with social media and politics. I blame social media for a lot, by the way. I'm not going to get into that.
Ken, you done opened up a whole nother can of worms.
Ken,
with
I was
the kids,
lucky.
Right?
I just, present, you know what it is? I mean, well, my particular situation, I just believe when it comes to co-parenting, because of my situation and because of the setup I have with my daughter and my daughter's mom, I believe with co-parenting, it can work. It can, you know, you guys can coexist. Just don't get in each other's way, especially if you guys can agree that it's not going to work or, you know, that type of thing. So, I don't want to stray too far. Unless you have other questions that I can answer, that's cool.
So let me
stray too far.
Let me say this, Ken. Again, I want to say thank you. We only have a few minutes left, and I want to make sure I bring Michelle Patton-Coy back on the line. And we already have two callers on the line. But I want to say thank you so much again for the love and support. Thank you for giving empowerment, positive words towards the women who have been speaking up about their experiences with parenting. And thank you so much for being a positive role model for your daughter.
Always. Thank
All
you.
Right.
Thank you
so I love you. I'll talk to you later.
Bye, Kenan.
All right. Love you. Bye-bye.
All right.
Bye,
Kenan. Bye, Kenan.
So bye-bye. Can we bring in Michelle? Michelle back? All right. Hang up, Ken. All right. So what are you guys hearing? Andrea, Danny, Janessa.
I'm hearing things that I didn't experience, which is very, very good and very enriching for me because, like I said, my kids are from a different era. They're not kids anymore. They're two men.
Okay.
Basically. And like I said, it was very difficult, you know, to raise them because there's no book. Nobody knows how to
That's
do it.
That's right. It doesn't come with a book. If it did, we'd all be perfect parents.
I just did what my parents did.
Yeah.
Right.
Good and bad.
Okay.
Let's be honest. Mm-hmm. Or just wasn't, you know, always the most useful or helpful thing, but you come from where you come from. But I'm enjoying hearing the experience of people who have younger children and are doing it now. Like I said, I don't know what I would do. A lot of drinking or something, right. You know? Like,
Danny.
No, I'm just saying, no, really. I don't, I never... I'm not going to say never because things could happen and I might end up, you know, grandkids raising or whatever. But I'm just saying I won't have these experiences like that, you know, like how you have. And especially Michelle and Rosalind has with the different age levels now, especially in this social media society.
Right. Oh, my Michelle, gosh. You back on the line?
Yes, I am.
Yay! Okay. Hey. Janessa, sure, bring it out, Janessa.
Okay, so to the ladies that have sons, Danny, because you have older men, I was wondering, because I found it difficult for myself to rear my son as far as discipline goes. I'll give you a quick example because I know we're limited on time. One day he had took some chalk and wrote in the street some bad words about the babysitter's husband. Okay. So I made him go downstairs and clean it with a toothbrush.
Yeah, I made them clean St. Albans Park up before.
So,
but that's abuse.
The whole park?
Yeah.
No, just the part. I told the gentleman in there, y'all take a break because these two gentlemen are going to clean it up. I saw them throw something on the ground and they said, oh, this park is dirty. And I said, you contributed to it. And someone called my mother on me.
Wow. That's deep.
Go ahead, Janessa. How my concern is when I'm disciplining him, because I'm always in mommy mode when I'm disciplining him, but at the same time, I wonder if I'm like emasculating him or humiliating him as a man.
If he's a big, strong boy like I had, they're looking at you like,
yeah,
she's not really hurting me. And when you get to the point where you try to hit them, then you'll know yourself. You'll go, my hand hurt.
Yeah. Because I mean, it's time to reach for items.
It's time to talk.
Yeah, it's time to talk. I get it. So I was just wondering, like, as a mother, how do you handle it? Because
I told you, I made them clean the park. You take away things, you know, just. There was no social, like I said, social media wasn't so popular as it is now. So they had a few little electronic games, you know, you take those away. Or sometimes I would use, you know, which is real, like rigid, like my mother, some tough love. And I'll say, well, you know, you drop that piece of paper on the floor, but you're the same person that'll walk by and say that the town is dirty. Would you like to clean it up?
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know.
Right.
And I
show them what'll happen.
Let me know if you ladies agree, even Michelle and Rosalind as well. I believe in effective communication. But sometimes it doesn't take you very as far as you would want it to take you.
Right.
And the way that society is now with corporal punishment, you have to be very, very mindful about laying your hands on children. But I must say that some of that, and not to say to abuse your children, but some of that needs to come back because think we can kind of keep the kids in a line a little bit better. But effective communication, I think it works, but it's just a slower process. Right. And there are times with my 15-year-old son, because he's getting older, and I think Rosalind said it earlier about that puberty stage when he was going through that stage. You know, it was like, okay, you know exactly what, not one button, but how many buttons. And I think about 10 or 15 of them, and you on all of them. You know, and you're
sitting on
them. At first, I thought I was underneath the water and I was breathing a little bit. Now I'm drowning.
Yeah, he's
something ain't right here.
You know,
and then sometimes you feel like what I have to do is I mind my personal space when my son pisses me off. Because in order for me to have this dialogue with you, you over there, I'm over here, and let's have this conversation. And sometimes the boys will challenge you.
How we as a mother, this? Are we
the boys will
like
challenge
a gentleman?
You
yes.
with the girls, because I think Michelle brought this up earlier. They have different personalities, and you love your children differently. I love all my children, but I love them differently based on their personalities and
you
their characteristics,
yeah.
Right? So my daughters, not really Kayla, she's a little more sassy now at 19, but Ashley is very sassy and mouthy.
Wait.
So I have to also make sure I collect enough personal space, and we need to have this conversation to let you know who's the adult in the home. You know, so that's what I wanted to talk about too, about the rules and regulations. How do we as parents reinforce those rules and regulations in our house, and they listen to them with everything else that's going on outside?
It's called effective communication, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
I
agree.
I am with my daughter. I never had to beat her or anything.
Yeah.
And it comes with communication. It's like when you grow up and you love on your child and they realize that it's just you and them, they know that we in this together. If you raise them that way, then that's the way they're going to be. You know what I mean? It's like, well, I'm going to go down the street and go to the store and I'm going to buy, I don't know, this thong just because I want to buy it.
No, you're not.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But it's like, would your mom want you to buy that? Or would your grandmother want you to buy that? Or do you think that's the right thing
you're
doing?
And even if they do it, it comes back because my sons who are grown, then they'll say, oh, you know, I did such and such, and I know you told me not to, and then this is what happened. So I tried to show them ahead of time what it's going to result
right.
in.
Right. That's exactly.
So when you do that, so this is what's going to happen. Or you now. See that person there, he's told it yeah. off to jail.
It's communication.
Because of right. that. So I try to communicate that.
So
right.
really quickly, because I think
and
this,
I agree with,
Rosalind, give me 2 seconds.
What?
Rosie, okay. give me 2 seconds. Okay. I think this conversation was real hot and spicy tonight, because I didn't even get to my Facebook people. So I want to say thank you so much. My social media people, speaking about social media, they were on and popping over here. So I want to make sure I paid them some attention here.
Shout out yeah. to
my phone
FB
was
social
down.
Media.
I was into this conversation. So I just want to say shout out to Dee Dee. That's also some family. Right. She said definitely need the man in the house. Who the heck is asking where is the man? As I got that, I guess that question is for you, Michelle. Kian, he already called in, so I don't have to mention that. Camrod, he said, hey, what's up? So thank you so much for that. I think it's Damon Drew. Balance is important towards peace when it comes to raising our children for both boys and girls. Every child needs their mother and father. Shout out to all the women who are raising their children on their own. Being a single parent isn't easy. Great conversation, ladies. All right. So I just want to say thank you so much to those few viewers and supporters that I got to on Facebook. And I'm sorry if I haven't gotten to all the questions, but I want to make sure that the ladies are able to fully discuss everything that's on their mind. Okay, back to you, Michelle and Rosalind. And I think Janessa was just saying something. Did I cut you off?
No, I don't think so. I think you were talking.
Andrea?
I was actually, okay. Roz was actually saying something.
All right, Rosalind, go ahead. And then I want to bring Andrea back okay. in.
Yeah, I was just agreeing with a lot with what you all were saying. Is I think it takes what seems to be working for us right now is I do talk a lot because I want my son to understand mm-hmm. my thought process yeah. because I'm trying to teach him how to reason through decisions and understand right. consequences.
Right.
Yeah, now, in addition to that talking, it also goes to him understanding that we're in this together. You know, right. we've always been right, very, Andrew. Very close.
It makes a difference.
And his dad was definitely part of that. But I think my son always has understood that, you know, we're like two peas in a pot in a lot yeah. of ways. And so, you know, but then when the talk, when the communication, you know, when it's not getting through the way that I would like it to or that it needs to, because I'm seeing certain behaviors, then, you know, he has to understand that there are consequences. And sometimes, you know, when I take games away or I say no TV, no phone, or, you know, mm-hmm. it's not like he spends a lot of time on that stuff, but he appreciates his half an hour show that he gets to watch. So when he misses that, he feels it, you know, and I make sure that even if it would be a little easier for me to have him have that time, because then it frees me up for other stuff. Like, no, this is a consequence. You got to feel that. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, there was a period in time, sometimes things go in ebbs and flows and cycles or waves. And, you know, there was a time when I felt like, I know I'm not quite getting through to him the way that I feel like I should be. Like, it's just not sinking in. Mm. Two things with that. Sometimes I feel like it's not sinking in, but I persist, and then it's like he has his aha moment, and it's a beautiful thing. And you know,
but it came yeah. from the communication. They hear you, yeah, but even though it may not seem like they hear you.
I'm just
that
right now. You know, I don't want to do that.
It takes so long for the results, and I'm like impatient.
Because I want to do what I want right now. Right. That instant gratification.
Right. Absolutely.
But see, that's when I have, you know, he has like an uncle that I'm real cool with that right. I trust. You know, I'm grateful to have some men in the community and in our family that I really can entrust him with and know that what they're telling him, they may say it differently. They may come with it from a different angle, but he's going to get that positive message from them. So I'll be like, yo, Uncle Sinful, check mm-hmm. it. I need you to, you know, spend a little time with Authenay and hear the issues, you know, and you'll see. You know, he's getting a little hard-headed, and, you know, I'm doing a lot of talking. And, you know, and I know that those family members have my back. So, you know, it's like it diversifies the message, and he's getting it from all angles.
That's
you know?
Right, because then there's no splitting. Let me bring Michelle in, Rosalind. Rosalind, mm-hmm. Michelle, how are you feeling right now? Because I know you said as far as this, being the disciplinarian, now you have to take on that role, whereas before you didn't. So how are you feeling about that?
Well, I don't want to give the impression that I didn't take on the role, but I had a different
way of dealing with it than my late husband did.
Okay. Talk to us.
And when it got to a certain stage, yes, I would say that was his role. But it's all division of resources. It's all, you know, my late husband used to cook. And I was like the sous chef. He used to do all the cooking. So now I can cook a mean oxtail and some rice and peas. But a lot, I could say that, oh, I'm better for it. But at the same time, that's a hard way to have to learn
how to do things.
Yeah, situations.
And I think that gets back to the question that was on my mind when I was listening to the conversation. I know that we all want, if we dream of a world that's, we want the best possible things for our children. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I think we, especially as Black women, embrace struggle so much.
Yeah.
Too much sometimes.
We like the hard road.
Glamorize this struggle. You know, and I don't want us to do that. I think that it's important to acknowledge, as we have tonight, that it's challenging. Mm-hmm. And speaking for myself, I would not wish this experience on my children. So I speak to my children a lot about lifestyle and what they would like for themselves and how they view themselves in the future. What jobs would they like to have? Because what lifestyle would you like to lead? I speak to them about those things. And I recognize that I made certain choices in my life. And look, life happens.
Yeah.
Nobody knew Daddy was going to die. Life happens. But we talk about those things. And I'm, frankly, you know, I have to give myself a timeout when I'm dealing with them sometimes. It's frustrating for me just to make sure that I'm communicating in the best way I can.
On that level.
I know that we take on so much and we're successful and we've made it work. But that doesn't mean I want my children to have to be doing what I'm doing right now. You know, I don't want that for them. You know, so
yes,
I'm trying.
Yes,
I'm
I get
reading
what you're saying.
A lot. I think I'm reading more now than I did when I was in law school and college. I'm reading
researching more than what you had to. Yes,
yeah. I'm trying to figure out how to impart certain ideas to them.
I'll put them in a position where they can compete.
Let them be more successful. You say you're reading more. I'm praying more.
Girl.
Yeah.
Praying nonstop.
Andrea says she's praying more.
I'm praying more.
Life changes you. That's right.
It humbles you.
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
As long as they're happy too.
Yeah.
And they, you know, have their bearings. You know, I'm sure you're doing an excellent job. I've been around you and worked with you and learned a hill of stuff.
You'd be surprised.
From you. Yeah. You'd be surprised because I'm that kind of person that believes, and I actually put it as a meme on Facebook. You have to be an idiot not to think that you can learn something from
everybody.
You said that before.
Yes.
One of the posts
I love that. That's why I always talk to all different kinds of people and always listen and watch other people. But I get what you're saying, Michelle, about them being able to compete and being able to not do what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That is so important. And kudos to you for that.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, ladies, what is something that you would say to a parent out there? Okay, so that's a general statement.
Janessa, it is because, like I said, just a little bit deeper on that.
Well, I don't want to say just moms, just fathers. You know, I want to say parents. Period. What would you say about the process? What words of encouragement, empowerment would you give them?
Every day ain't gonna be a good day. It's not, and it's hard. And we struggle, we fight, we push, we pull, we drag, we kick, and we scream. But every day, when you look at that baby, no matter how old they are, from a newborn to how old your baby's in, no matter how old they are, when you look at them, they still your babies. When, yeah, like I said in the very beginning.
It's hard sometimes because I'm still a baby to my mama, and it's
yes,
hard.
Yes, it is.
It's hard.
But to know that... Yes. all that we have done as parents, all the mistakes that we have made, all the failures that we think we've made, because there's some days where I think I've failed.
Right.
And
you start
questioning, yeah, you start questioning your parenting.
Ain't it?
And then they do something miraculous.
Oh, yeah.
Then they do something amazing. Like then Audrey there is smile. Something where you know that prayer has been answered.
Yes, somebody was
I am an example of that for my mother, for my parents. I was an example for that. And looking at those two babies, 2 degrees on one, and we looking at MIT for the other one.
Wow.
And all right now. Yeah. It's amazing. So that struggle, it's okay. Those tears, they're okay. Those tears mean you're fighting. Mm-hmm. Those tears mean you haven't given up.
It's a release, too.
It's a release, and there's greatness in everything that you do. And when they do it, you go, I wasn't so bad. I did a good job.
I'm telling you.
And you can pat yourself on the back. It's okay.
This shall pass.
It's okay to go, I did a good job, or I did the best I could mm-hmm. do. And not be ashamed of it. Like, wow.
It wasn't so bad at all. No.
All right. Andrea.
Like you said, that's what I was going to do, actually. Quote a couple of scriptures.
Okay.
Well, that's the way I was raised.
Give it to us.
You know, that's what we had to do. Let me see. One I would say is life and death is in the power of your tongue. So know that when you speak to your kids, when you teach your kids, you want to speak life. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter if they're doing negativity. Yes. You have to find the positive in it and encourage them, because you really don't realize how much it means to them and how much that peer pressure will come along. Yeah. But they know mom gotcha said or mom is there
and
mom knows. You know what I mean? Or
drill, right? Yes.
Another one I could say is, how you say it? Speak things that are not as though they were. So you know, you might have a child that's suffering with depression. You might have a child that's suffering with mental illness. You know, you got to talk as if it doesn't exist. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Don't let your child think that it's going to crush them and make them
build
somebody
self-esteem.
Who has to be isolated from build the
it.
World. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a lot of people going through these things.
You're right.
And
yeah,
as parents,
right.
if you have a child now, dealing with some kind of mental illness, it's okay. You know, you just have to show them that they're unique, and it's not a bad thing to be that way. You know, you got to speak life into them. It's going to be okay.
That's right.
You know, right now might be a little hard. Right now, things don't seem right. But let's talk about something that happened last time. You know, last week or 2 weeks ago. And look where we at today.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's not easy, once again, but it's not impossible.
Good stuff.
It's not impossible.
Danny.
Well, I would say, hold on.
Hold on.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's going to be a ride.
Oh, yes.
And don't kick yourself for what you do. Don't kick, you know, yourself and knock yourself down and knock down your spirit, because they know it.
Mm-hmm.
They know it even when you're in the living room.
Mm-hmm.
And just, you know, be rigid. Not as rigid as Danny, but
it worked.
Just, you know, hold them and always let them know. See this face? Alpha and Omega.
That's right.
When you fall, I'll be right there looking at you. You know, you fall down. Come
That's
on
right.
over. Bring it in.
So I want to piggyback off of something that Danny said, and then I'm going to get to Rosalind and Michelle. Really quickly, I had to learn as a parent that just because I'm the parent, just because I'm older, just because I'm the adult, doesn't mean that I can't learn from my children.
Right.
My children teach me. They teach me so much. And sometimes they teach me how to parent.
Yeah.
And what tools to use to parent each one of them based on their characteristics.
Right. And like I said, what's going on.
That's right. And keep you. Yeah.
Well, I listened to this rap and the rap before that.
That's right. That's right.
My kids taught me how to listen.
You have to be. You have to kind of meet your children where they are.
Yeah.
You know, and
keep that communication open.
Right. And I think, thank you for saying that. Yeah. I think that the communication between you and your child, you and your children, is very, very important because when they are faced with adversity, when they are faced with trials and tribulations, when they are struggling, they hear that silent, like it's like almost a whisper or echo of what mommy said,
right.
what daddy
That's
said, what grandma
exactly.
said, what grandpa said, whoever was an integral part in their life, they hear that positive stuff.
Right.
And I think Rosalind mentioned that a little bit earlier
when
she said that Yeah, I didn't have the most effective parent, but throughout the process, I met people who brought me life, who spoke life into me, and this is the reason why I'm now able to parent Orsine. So now I'm going to hand the mic over to Rosalind and ask you what you would say to a parent as a sense of empowerment and stuff like that. Roz?
Yeah, well, I would say, you know, I really do... I work very, very hard parenting, and I think, you know, I do a hell of a job, and like you all were saying, it's not easy, but it's definitely the thing that I'm most proud of. Yeah. And it's funny because, you know, if I look at my resume and it has, you know, law school and this, you know, just the different things that I've done, and it's funny because that's not on there, but if you, and without question, that is the thing that I feel like has
the most
shaped me, is definitely the thing that is most important to me and that I'm most proud of. And communication, like we were all saying, is so very important. The firmness, you know, being firm with your child, because being firm and resolute in being a parent and setting boundaries and teaching them is so very important, and that will build their trust. And it's, you know, it's a balance because, you know, it's like you're balancing setting boundaries and teaching respect and requiring, you know, respect with their brilliance and their abilities and them figuring, you know, their confidence. Mm-hmm. So it's not always an easy balance, but it's one that, you know, as a parent, it's really important that we figure out and sometimes part of that is working out some of those details with our child, you know, like having conversations about this is what I'm trying to teach you here. And have little breakthroughs. Sometimes I'll say to him, like, you're engaging in this pattern of behavior, I don't want to just punish you all the time. So what would you do if you were in my position? You know, just so they understand that it's challenge. Not just all, oh, here she go again.
Yeah.
Right? Oh, no.
You got it. Don't want to hear that.
You know, but it is a beautiful journey. Yes. And, you know, we, like Michelle said, I know all of us on this panel want the absolute best. For our children. Ooh. And a beautiful life for our children. And I think that regardless of the journey that they take, because of the love and the example that we've shown them, I think they you know, they're going to be more than all right. They're going to be brilliant. And they already are showing their brilliance.
Absolutely. Yeah, so, Michelle, let me bring you in. How are you feeling? What are your empowering words?
I'm feeling very grateful that I had an opportunity to have these 2 hours with you ladies, because it really helps me to center and realize that I'm not alone in a lot of the things that I'm going through. Mm-hmm. And it's helpful. And I often, you know, piggybacking on what Rosalind said, I often ask my children, or I'll say, listen, this is my first time with a teenager. So you have to give me a break, too. Yeah. I'm trying new things.
Get out the bathroom.
You're going through changes. Like, my daughter is 13, about to be 14. You can imagine what that time period in life brings.
Yes.
And we know what you're saying. I have never had, you're my first child. I haven't seen this before.
We in here praying with you right now.
Yes. Do you feel the waves over there?
You said 14. We are praying for you right now. Let me help you, Michelle. Father God, in the name of Jesus.
I think we're kind of jealous of you tomorrow.
Yes, girl.
Ooh, Michelle. Yes, have a cold one, dear.
Did you hear my prayer, Michelle? Father God, in the name of Jesus. Okay? We are with you.
Going on 29. 14 going on 29. Yes, I have a niece. Oh, yes.
Yeah. Ooh. I got an 11-year-old. She's about 80.
Yeah. Some girls will do it to you, though.
Oh, yeah. The girls are different. There's a big difference between Michelle, the boys and the girls.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Michelle, you weren't finished, sis. Weren't you still saying
I mean, no. I'm... I think I am finished.
Michelle, give me 1 minute.
Roslyn, shut it down.
Hey, Roslyn, are you on that parenting thing again? Did you just shut us down?
Shut it down. She was speaking.
No. But see, I was quiet, Roslyn. Like, all commiserating. Because, you know, I remember what I was like at 14 and 15. And it's bad when you look back. And I actually was a very independent kid. I worked from the age of 14, you know. And even the responsibility, I looked at how I was when I was 14 and 15. When I was 17, I was like, ooh. I was a hot ass mess.
Yes, girl. I was a real.
Janessa kind of expounded on that.
Yes.
So yeah. Listen, I don't. I've been flagged down by the engineer to say that we only have 2 minutes left.
Wow.
And in that 2 minutes, I absolutely have to say thank you, and I have to humble myself and just say thank you 8 times because we have some callers. Mm-hmm. 9 times. We have some callers. We have Facebook people. Everybody who tuned in to buildingsafercommunities.com/radio. I just want to thank you for the love, for the support, for the continued support, by the way. You know, and we can't do this without you. Just the same as parenting, we cannot do this without you. It takes a village to have this conversation. It takes a village to raise children, whether it be in a two family, single family home. We have the resources are out there. Mm-hmm. And for some of us, we have them sooner than later, mm-hmm. you know, and everybody's situation is different. But I want to say thank you to Janessa. I want to say thank you to Andrea. Thank you so much, Danny. Thank you, Michelle. Thank you, Roslyn. Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Ken. Thank you, Dee from South Carolina. Thank you to the viewers and supporters on Facebook and the ones that tuned in on the website. I love you guys. And you know, I start getting all sentimental.
Thank you for having us.
So I got to pull myself back.
Yes. Thank you for having us.
Good hearing from you, Michelle and Roslyn.
Yes.
This was like the connection, right?
Yeah.
This was the connection.
We haven't seen each other since 120.
Yeah. But let me tell you something. That speaks volumes to how much we have accomplished.
Yes.
You know, yes. And the fact that when we do meet with next. Each other,
yes.
right?
It's beautiful.
Meet with each other, we have something positive to say.
To talk about. Yeah.
We got something good to talk about.
We are supportive.
Yeah. We are a bag yes. of resources for each other, and we strengthen each other. God only knows what we were feeling before we walked through this door, before you guys called in.
Yeah.
God only building? Knows. Right. Danny got off the elevator. She was looking teed off.
Yeah.
Right. So God only knows what the viewers and supporters were feeling before they heard us speak tonight. So
I want to say
somebody
thank you.
Got the message.
Yeah. And for all that you do, and not just tonight, but everything, yeah, everything that you're feeding exactly. back into Anytime. The community and to social media. Yeah. I just want to commend you on everything that you're doing and the positive energy that you bring. Mm-hmm. I watch you. I follow you. I am so proud of my sister and my friend.
Thank you.
So we definitely yeah. have to commend you for
she did
thank
that
you.
Business owner.
She did that. Hey, she slay. Hi, mama. Because my mama's you. Watching on Facebook yes. and my sister Jill.
All right, give those shout outs. Who's watching, Danny? Who's watching, Danny?
I don't know.
Danny's sister. She was trying to call in.
Who's watching?
She said she was gonna watch.
Oh, I got family. I got friends. I got family, friends, family, and more friends.
And
my daughter watching.
Yes.
Hey, Shy.
Hey. Well, Ersie, if you watch it,
right. I got a coworker working.
My sissy.
Hey.
They all, my yes. family was like, what's the number? Yes. Try to get the number.
I was like last minute, but I'm so glad I
can't
I came.
Be sitting here in Texas. I'm trying yes. to pay attention. So, and Mama course, and Jules, love y'all.
Oh, last minute stuff.
That's right. And we are a breath. We multitask yeah. as parents. I forgot to say.
Oh, yeah.
We have so many different hats and roles, and we washing the clothes, and we doing
cooking
the laundry,
dinner,
and we doing homework.
Talking to them at the same time. Can you do that?
How am I gonna? And then you'd be surprised. You got it all done.
You done.
That's right.
And the bonus is,
you're done.
The bonus is, we got these kids, so y'all get in there and clean that bathroom. You get in here and do them
you
dishes.
Start delegating.
Somebody start sorting this laundry, because you know what? And it'll get to a point where, let me tell you, let me share this with y'all. I have just cut my daughter off, and I'm so proud. Can y'all give that up for me? Because
yes,
I was paying all her bills.
And she wow. paid all bills today.
Last night, I had her sit down with her
Wait
little checkbook.
Back,
Wait, no, she got money in her bank account. She's working and everything. I had my daughter sit down and write her very first check
That's right.
to pay her student
all
loans.
Right. Okay,
so yeah. I'm like, I'm going
to learn
how to
the adult world.
Welcome to the adult world.
She said that earlier.
I said, y'all need to, I'm going to just let her pay her bills, because, you know, you start paying, you going to start paying her bills, because you want to help your baby. Well, I want to help you be responsible. Well, it's going to fall back on you anyway when they don't. I want to help you learn how to do your finances and take care of your credit.
You got this.
That's another story that we need to get into. But she going to learn how to write a check.
It builds character. So with that being said, ladies, thank you. Thank you so much.
Yes.
I love you guys.
Thank you.
Yes. You've been tuned into Questions, Answers, and Solutions. Tune in next week between 8 to 10. Thank you so much, Rima. Thank you so much.
Yes,
to my
Rima.
To my number one supporter, Todd Taylor.
Hi. Night, Michelle. Night, Rosie.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
This was amazing.